I guess I'll just call it Max White Presents.
Max White, everyone!
But I've actually got another podcast coming out soon. I just need to fucking try and get the dates right. I'm going to be doing one with my friend who's currently in prison. And we're going to try and record a podcast together through him when he's on the phone time.
Damn, that's like, so you have the recorded sound through the phone?
Yeah. We're going to record it. And it's basically him, and we're going to try and do a podcast. And he should be being released soon. So, you know, if we can't do it like that, we'll just wait till he gets out, and I'm going to do a podcast with him as well. And
Your guys' prison sounds so nice there. I know they're not, but like, they're called Her Majesty's.
Yeah. Because when you're in prison, you're under Her Majesty's pleasure.
Really?
Yeah. So you're in prison at Her Majesty's pleasure. So until, you know, because you can get pardoned by the Queen and shit. Like, I don't forget if it happens, but you can.
Yeah. I watched The Crown.
Yeah. So it's like Her Majesty's pleasure. But it's just because American prisons are so, you know, in movies and fucking, you know, and they're so spoken about, and a lot of times some of the fucking worst, like violent wise.
Yeah.
That kind of, they just overshadow everyone else's prisons. Like, other countries' prisons are bad. It's just that yours are fucking terrifying.
And they're not like and the terrifying is the norm. It's not like that, you know, like in Bolivia that we went on TV, like, oh, well, the one prisoner that's the leader gets a gun to keep the whole wing in check. That's an exception. Ours are like, you know, we just had that, I think it was in Mississippi, somewhere down south, where basically the warden's boss was in charge of all the finances for all the prisons in that area. And any money he saved on food for the inmates, he kept as a bonus. You hear about this?
I didn't hear about that one. What I did hear about, though, is that's not the judge, that's not the jail, the Arizona sheriff.
No, that's Sheriff Joe. That guy is fucking
Jesus. Who's famous for cutting corners, but
and he's so closeted gay. Can we just talk about that?
I never know about that.
He's making everyone wear pink underwear, and he thinks it's hilarious. Like, pink is a great color. What's his? This dude is like an antiquated, closeted Republican.
Yeah. I remember, like, he was like, they want an exercise machine, they want electricity, so you have to cycle.
Yeah, and then they put him in tent cities, and it's like, dude.
He's a motherfucker, man.
That's just what shows you, particularly in this country, that if you're, like, closeted and gay, and, like, you're from a very place that isn't accepting, you go so hard against who you actually are inside. Like our Republican senator that got caught trying to suck dick in the men's bathroom in Minneapolis Airport, Larry Scott, I almost said Larry David. It's a senator from Minneapolis. Did you hear this story?
No.
He was trying to do apparently in the gay community, there's like foot signals when you're in a public restroom to let the guy next to you know that they're gay. Well, there was an undercover cop in the Minneapolis airport bathroom stall next to him. And the dude was trying to do like foot pedal, gas pedal, trying to get his dick sucked. And then he got arrested. And this guy is like hardcore anti-gay. So Sheriff Joe is so gay.
Did you hear about the Hungarian guy who's like a minister for this far right wing Hungarian politician, and he got and he's like anti hardcore anti gay, and he got caught in a gay orgy in Brussels. Dude. This happened a couple weeks ago. Yeah, he got caught in a gay orgy in Brussels and tried to jump out the window.
That's how it always goes. I feel so bad for him though. Like, it's like it's a classic movie villain shit where you're like, You're all this pent up who you really are, and so not only do you like you don't get to be who you are, but then you go toxic, and then you get mean, and then you take it out on the people.
I mean, a lot of times it's because you hate it about yourself.
Yeah,
you hate it in other people because, you know, there's only so much you can hate yourself, so you express it by hating the thing when it's not the thing that's the issue. It's how you're dealing with it, you know.
It's also not like it's not just hating though. You're running for office and then you're legislating against that thing. It's the most bitch ass shit I've ever heard of in my entire life.
I mean, that's what happens though, man. And it's like, and it's not even that. It's like just an internal feeling. He's acting out on it. Not that there's nothing wrong with him acting out on it, but he's acting out on it because he knows that's what he is. It's not like he has this thing in the back of his mind and he suppresses it. He's doing it. He's doing the thing, but he has to be so anti it because he every time he does it, he feels awful. You know what I'm saying? Like, dude. You know, and it's with that thing of it, you know, it's sending fucking crazy and poor, you know, I feel sorry for them, even though that they're sort of the way they express it is highly negative by, you know.
Max White presents. What advice would you give a new comic starting out? Like, let's pretend COVID didn't happen, and then we can do one where COVID is happening. And it has to be other than do more stage time, because it's a fucking bullshit answer. It's a true
I
one.
I don't think that's number one. I don't think it's bullshit. I think that's the honest truth. And whenever
it's the most important thing, but it's like saying, how do you live your day? Don't forget to breathe. You have to do as much stage time as possible.
I think people. And the only reason, and I'm not going to debate you, and I will give another answer, but I think, you know, and I know why you're saying it, because that's one thing every comic does say, is just get more stage time.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it is probably number one. And when I say get more stage time, I don't just mean it as the general sense of just next question, please. I mean it like people genuinely, because comedy now has become a business where there is an avenue to do it. Like there's in England, there's university courses in comedy. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
There is a real set way of how you can make it or how you can get into the business. But, and people like, because I get new comics asking me who have been doing it for fucking 6 months, how do I get an agent? And it's like, forget about that shit.
Yeah.
It's about getting up. And it's like, people think getting up a lot is twice a week. I'm talking about, you got to fucking get up seven, eight times a week, you know? But anyway, but if I had to give advice to a new comedian, it would be, I'll tell you this one. Enjoy the beginning and enjoy the hard times. Do you know what I'm saying? Because those are going to be your best memories. So don't worry too much about those times where it's hard and you're struggling. Because those are the memories you're going to enjoy the most. Do you know what I mean? Like the funnest times I had in comedy was me and, you know, a couple comedians. We ain't got fucking nothing going on in the business. We haven't earned a penny of comedy. We're all broke. And we would fucking, you know, talk shit to fucking 3 o'clock in the morning because we all ain't got nothing to do tomorrow. No one's got to wake up and write a fucking script draft and, you know what I mean? No one's got to have a fucking meeting. Everyone's got fuck all going on. And we just talk shit and fucking laugh our fucking tits off, pretending that we knew anything about comedy. And these are your funnest times, man. And I think the problem is now what I see with a lot of new comics, because especially in England, there's a real fast trajectory. Like, there's people who are on TV after their first year, 2 years in comedy.
Yeah.
That, you know, you'll see that happening to people, your peers, and you'll start hating your, you know, because when I started, no one in their first year of comedy was put on TV really. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't have that where it's like, oh fuck, that person I know is now on Live to Apollo. Like, I never had that. But, you know, and I know it's harder now than it was when I was younger, but enjoy that time, because that time's going to be your memories. You know what I'm saying? That time's going to be the funnest and easiest time. And there's something freeing about being able to be shit. Do you know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Like, now I have pressure now. Like, I sell tickets, so motherfuckers come to the show and they come to see you and they're ready to see it, and they're not, you know, they ain't got time for me just to be shit. They're like, bub, I've got a fucking babysitter. You know what I'm saying? Like, let fucking Jamali bring it.
I got a new shirt for this.
You know what I'm saying? Where, you know, there's something really enjoyable and freeing about being shit and having nothing on and just, you know, being fucking young, or even if you're old, you know, but being young and having fuck all on, man, and enjoy that moment and don't rush and don't, you know, savor those minutes, because that's going to be your, you know, that's going to be your memories, man.
I guess I'll just call it Max White Presents.
Max White,